Welcome to the Medical Device Made Easy podcast. Here is Munir Elazouzi from easymedicaldevice.com. And today we will go to talk about the class one products, but not the normal class one. I call it the class one special or class one specific because there is some specificities to this product. So for that, I have with me LM Ein from SER Medical. So she will help us to understand what you should expect from these products, what are the status regarding the regulation, and specifically the medical device regulation. So she will really help us to understand what you should do to place these products on the market. Okay, so LM, welcome to the Medical Device Made Easy podcast.
Thank you. Thank you, Monier, for inviting me in your podcast. I'm a follower of it, and it's really easy to understand and really useful. So really proud of what you are doing. So just to introduce myself, I have founded ACR Medical for audit consulting regulation, and I'm working as a regulatory affairs consultant. I'm also a member of DEM Expert Network in France.
Okay.
I started my career in research and development in microbiology, oncology, and also in biochemistry. And then I obtained 2 degrees in business development. So I had the opportunity to work in several fields like purchasing, sales, marketing, quality, regulatory affairs, and supply chain. And in particular in sterilization. But I wanted to specialize myself in regulatory affairs in medical device. So I obtained a master's degree in this field. And then I have worked especially in class one reusable. Under MDR.
Great. So as you can hear, Alem is French because she has a French accent. And I can see really that you choose the right field. So from business going to regulatory affairs, it's I don't see a lot of people doing that, but I think it's because you really liked it. Let's now dig in the topic. So related to the class one products, can we make just a small reminder to people about class one and the specificities of it. So how many classes we have in class one?
So for sure. So as you said at the beginning, we have the class one normal and the class one specific. And under the class one specific, we have 3 types of devices. So we have the class one sterile, the class one with a measuring function, and the class one reusable. So we have
three. And this last one is a new one, I think.
Yeah, and the class one reusable is new regarding the MDR. It's just appeared with the MDR. So it's a new class, and it respects the rule 6 in Annex 8. Yeah.
Okay. And so what is for you, if I can say, the difference between the class one and class one special? So is there a major difference for the audience?
Yeah, for sure, because the class one normal don't need the involvement of a notified body, and the class one specific need the involvement of the notified body.
Okay, so it's a major difference, I think, for people. For class one, you have your products that are self-certified. So it means that you have to gather all the documents to create them by yourself. And then you self-certify yourself, means that you are creating your declaration of conformity, you sign it, and then you say that, I can now sell my products in the countries. But for the class one specific, so there is the involvement of notified bodies. So just one thing. So related to the MDR, there is the MDR that will be in place on the 26th of May, 2020. So Those products under class one or class one specific, when they should be compliant to MDR?
The class one specific, so especially for class one sterile and class one with a measuring function, they already have their CE certificate. So the validity is until the end of the validity date of their CE certificate.
Okay.
And they should be compliant with MDR after this date. And regarding the class one reusable, thanks to the second corrigendum, which has been published at the end of last year, they now have until 26 May 20 and 24 to be compliant with MDR.
Okay.
But I just want to say that the manufacturers don't have to wait until the last moment to be compliant with that, because they have to plan right their transitional period.
Yeah, I think we talked about that on a previous episode with Eric Volbrecht about the class one that were up classified, because as we've said, this class one air was not existing under the MDD. It was just a class one. And because of MDR, it was up classified to class one air. And because of that, as you mentioned, there is this second corrigendum that was used to extend the date. Mainly, I suppose, because there is some kind of issues now, a bottleneck to get some notified bodies for the people that already have a notified body. So I imagine the difficulty for those that don't have a notified body and need to find one now. Okay, just one specificity maybe or information. Can you help us to understand which products are really under class one reusable? Because I have a lot of my customers that contact me and say, oh, I'm benefiting from this extension until 2024 because my product is reusable, but I tell them no. So can we clarify this point and try to help the people to understand which products are really under class one air?
So the class one air is concerned reusable surgical instruments, especially. So it means an instrument intended for surgical use,
okay,
in cutting, drilling, sewing, scratching, scraping, clamping, retracting, and similar procedures. So without any connection in an active device,
okay,
because in this case it will be a class 2A, which is intended by the manufacturer to be reused after appropriate procedures.
Okay, so if your product is not doing that, it is not class one air. And it's really important to say that, because as I said, I'm struggling each time people are coming to me and saying, oh, Munir, my product is class one air. I have still some time before to put that on the market. And I say to them, I don't think so. And they are always, saying, no, I'm right. So I just want to clarify to people, yeah, those products are just surgical instruments that are, as LM said, scratching, drilling, etc. If they are not doing that, we cannot put them under class one air. So you have no extended period. So you have to have your products complying to the regulation by when?
For the class one normal, so by 26 May 2020.
So, it's
unreasonable. We have until 4 years.
Yeah, so you have few months now to be compliant to that. Okay, so I hope now it clarifies a lot of things for the people that are listening to this. Okay, so we have to have those products compliant at a certain date, if I can say. Now, what is the difference for people that have class one specific? So as we've said, we need now to involve a notified body.
Yes.
What will check the notified body? Is it the same as a class 2A, 2B or 3, or it's different?
It's just the involvement of the notified body is just limited in the critical aspects of the class, if it's sterile with a measuring function or reusable. So for the class one sterile, the notified body will audit the aspect relating to the establishing, securing, and maintaining the sterile conditions.
Okay.
For the class one with a measuring function, the audit will be limited to the aspects relating to the metrological requirements. And for the reusable, so the new one with MDR, the audit will be limited to the reuse of the device. So in fact, it's just the cleaning, disinfection, sterilization, the maintenance, and test, the functional testing, and the instruction for use also. So, but the manufacturer has to choose also a conformity assessment between Annex 9 and 11. So the Annex 9 is about the quality management system. So first, the manufacturer has to put in place a quality management system and a risk system. It's really important because I have some clients which ask me, I can also prepare the technical documentation. It's enough to get the CE marking.
Yeah. And
absolutely not. You have to put a quality management system first and then your technical documentation.
No, it's, I have the same discussions also. I have some people that are contacting me and they're saying to me, oh, I need your help to create my technical documentation. I say, yes, I can do that. And after I said, but what about the quality management system? What about the clinical evaluation? What about economic operators? What about? I say, oh, really? I need all that? I say, yes. I mean, the misconception of people is that they think that is what needs to be compliant is just the technical documentation. But with the class one now, there is more things to involve, and I think it's really important for people to understand that it's not the same as for the MDD. You have really to show that you have a full quality system. I mean, not a full. It's as we mentioned on previous episode, it's Article 10.9 of the MDR where you have to check that you are complying to those elements of the MDR. And as soon as you're complying to that, so you have the minimum quality management system requirements for your company. So in terms of, as we've said, so let's come back to the beginning. So you said that the notified body will look specifically at some aspects of the products, so sterile condition or measuring function, etc. What are they looking exactly? Because, I mean, are they looking for some reports? Are they looking for what kind of document they will be coming to audit? What document those manufacturers should have in place so that they can show that their product is complying to this classification?
So as I said, it's essentially the document included in the quality management system. So they will look at the quality manual first, and all the risk management system and all the things linked to the critical aspect, as I said. So for the sterile for the class one sterile, all the documents related to the to prove the sterile conditions of the device, and for the class one with the measuring function, it's the same. So the notified body will look at the quality management system, the risk management system, and all the documents related to which prove the metrological requirements of the device. And it's the same for the class one reusable. So they will look at the quality management system again, the risk management system also, and all the documents which prove how can we reuse the device. So the IFU especially, because in this document, the manufacturer which explain how he has validated his procedure regarding the reprocessing. So he will look
at all the documents. That, so mainly, for example, we have also a lot of manufacturers that have an IFU that says we should sterilize, we should clean like that, sterilize with steam sterilization with this amount of time, this temperature, etc., etc. They have to prove that this method is correct, if I can say, for their products. It's not only just to prove that, we use a standard procedure for sterilization. It's also to prove that this method is correct for their specific device.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, they have to prove that it's correct and validated also. It's really important.
So they cannot just put this standard method and say, anyway, everybody is using that, so I can use the same methodology on my IFU.
No, he has to validate it regarding the legal aspect in the country where he sell the product.
So yeah, it means that there is some also some local laws that are applying for those products. For example, if there is some local laws in France or local laws in Germany, they have to prove that those local laws are applying for their products and they are correct. So the notified body is checking specifically that, and it will give you the certificate only if you are complying with all those requirements.
Yeah, for sure. But the manufacturer has also to do its EU declaration of conformity in accordance with that Article 19 and Annex 4 of the MDR. And then if everything is complete, the notified body will give the C certificate, which covers all the products regarding the class 1 sterile, class 1 with a measuring function, and class 1 reusable.
And if they have the three kind of products on their portfolio, they will have three certificates, I suppose.
Yes, for sure. Yeah.
The so one for each.
Exactly.
Ellen, I think regarding the information for the auditors, so you also created the document, I think, to help them. So can you tell us more what is inside, so that maybe people can check what they can find if they download it from the show notes?
Yeah, for sure. So I explained that there is a guidance which has been published by the MDCG, so the Medical Device Coordination Group, and it's especially for the class 1, so all the class 1, normal and specific.
Yeah.
This guidance is really helpful, so I invite all the manufacturers and all people to read that in detail. And in my presentation, I just put all the necessary steps to be in compliance with the MDR. So there is 8-9 steps, and it's really helpful because it's easy to understand how to be compliant step by step regarding the MDR.
Okay. So I will put anywhere those information on the show notes. Please go on the show notes and download the documents that LM provided. I think you have also all the information inside, so you just have to get to the document, and there will be the links for all the sources and documents that you can use to be compliant. Okay, LM. So can you help us also understand how can you help the people in the audience if they have some question or if they have some projects like that?
Yeah, for sure. So I help them. The first thing is that I try to understand how kind of quality management system they put in place, how kind of documents there are already. So all the existing data. And then we try to do a gap analysis to be able to do an action plan. So I can help them to provide some trainings also, and some I can also do some audits, and so I'm a consultant, so I can give some some advice to manufacturers to be able to be in compliance with the MDR.
Okay, so great. So yeah, don't hesitate to contact LM if you have any question regarding what we discussed today about class 1, class 1S, M, and R. She will be really providing you all the information. Don't hesitate also to contact her if you need any support for any audit or any training. Okay, so thank you for that. So for the people that are listening, so thank you for your support. I see that a lot of people are looking at the podcast and providing some messages. So really thank you for that. Don't hesitate also to go to your platform where you are listening or watching the video to provide some review. It's really important just to be well-ranked, if I can say, on the different channels. And then to be able also to help more people to be compliant to the medical device regulation. Okay, so thank you for your help. And I hope that you will go to the show notes to get all the information that we provided today. And that LM wrote and provided us so that we can really download that. And I wish you really a nice day, LM.
Thank you. You too. Have a nice day, Monia.
Bye-bye.
Bye.